gentle and indolent. Then in 1917, the French planter, Monsieur Henri Fauconnier, decided to make this elegant idler earn a living. He laid out the first pioneer oil palm plantation with a processing factory in Selangor. And soon, other planters followed his example on a big scale. Today, more than 150,000 acres in Malaysia are planted with oil palms. Still elegant, but no longer idle, they are now producers of wealth for the country. At about 2.5 years of age, the oil palm starts to earn its living, constantly flowering and fruiting. When a bunch starts to shed a few loose fruits, it can be considered ripe for harvesting. Picked early or too late by a few days, the oil will lose quality. So every palm, and there are over 1 million trees in a large estate, must be visited at least once a week throughout the year. As the fruits quickly deteriorate once picked, they must be transported to the factory for processing without delay. To protect the plants, clearing and weeding of the undergrowth are carried out regularly and rigorously. This also keeps them within easy access. In big estates, lorries and trains are used to collect and carry the fruits from central points to the factory, to ensure that all fruits harvested are processed the same day. The Malaysian oil palm industry was not lucrative at first, but through the years, scientific research has paid dividends. Research, vital to the industry, is still going on every day. A member of a distinguished family, this particular tree is the subject of a long, continuous study. From the early history of its parents and grandparents to its own progress from a seedling. Now it is chosen to father a new generation of palms. Until the pollen is ripe, man protects the male flower from the natural means of cross-pollination, from insects and wind. Later, he will arrange a marriage for the eligible pollen with another palm. The nuptial ceremony is performed by a breeding expert. On another tree, the female flower has also been protected all this while from the wind-blown pollen of lesser suitors. Gorgeous in her bridal veil, she receives her groom. And the result, a fruitful union. The devotion of the research workers is endless. Each experiment is carefully observed and noted through all the stages. In the laboratory, the search for perfection goes on. The aim, a shorter plant and a higher yield of oil. A bigger fruit, but a smaller nutshell. Unlike the coconut, whose oil is derived entirely from the kernel, palm oil is contained both in the pericarp, or the fleshy covering of the nut, and in the kernel itself. But the nutshell is waste. fruits for breeding purpose or further experiment are carefully selected from those freshly harvested. They are first peeled of their outer coverings, the fleshy pulp and fibers, and then the seeds, almost naked, are taken away for germination. In this steam-heated germinating station are many strains of seeds, the products of many experiments worth thousands of dollars. They are precious, for they are seeds of hope for the future. Here the unborn seeds endure 8 hot, humid weeks as the life inside them is sprouting to the light. The seeds become transformed in the act of germination, thrusting out their first tiny roots. The life processes have been released within the baby palms. Only the most promising seedlings are planted. Closely tended and fostered by attentive men, the seedlings grow in a nursery garden. When a year old, the young palms are transplanted in the open field, but only the most healthy and vigorous of them. At this tender age, they are put in the shelter of the old palms. Another year or two, and the young ones will inherit the economic task of the adults. The old trees are poisoned and then felled for the new producers to take over. Their productive life is about 25 years, almost one human generation. One of the experiments has led to the dumpy palm. It's so named because of its appearance. Not only is it shorter, but it also bears more fruits. In Malaysia, forests are giving way to the palms. Once confined to the estates, the industry is now open to smallholders in the various land development schemes. It's a part of the national land policy. One such project was recently inaugurated in Kulai, in the state of Johor. Acres of virgin land and more than 400 new homes for the smallholders. All this is their hope for a better livelihood. Formerly landless, each family owns at present 10 acres of land for oil palms and 2 acres for cash crops. The government has given the settlers a good start, buildings and tools and subsistence allowance. The big estates have provided them with a young palm and later will help them process their fruits. The smallholder has a big job, raising nearly 500 palms. His future is firmly staked in his land. He will get more per acre from oil palm than from coconut or rubber, and he will get it earlier too. Within a short time, the smallholder will see the fruits of his labor. Apparently peaceful and placid, estate life is yet fraught with a natural drama of survival. The productive palms attract many enemies. Voracious elephants relish these succulent fronds and fruits. They are a threat to the palms. Yet, strangely enough, the python is the planter's ally. They have a common enemy, the rat. Smaller than the rats, but much more harmful, the rhinoceros beetles. Estate workers have to destroy their breeding grounds. The beetles begin their lives as harmless grubs, thriving in the rotting stumps of old palms. Right now, they must be removed. For if you leave them alone, the grubs will grow into beetles, feeding first on the fronds and foliage, and eventually destroying whole trees. Since the fruits must be processed on the day of the harvest, there is a factory in every oil palm estate or nearby. Before the fruits can be extracted for their valuable oil, they are heated, cooked, and sterilized in steam. Released from the steam cages, the fruits are crushed. Now the oil of the pericarp is extracted. Then the kernels are removed from the remains. Several thousand tons of kernels are sent overseas annually to be processed into finer oil. In the vats, the oil is purified, emerging rich in vitamins and food value. Some palm oil is consumed locally, as in the manufacture of soap and margarine. But the bulk of the Malaysian palm oil is exported to the world's markets, over 20 million gallons a year. The domain of a million palms, the oil palm estate, is also the home of the men and women who nurse, protect, and harvest them. And they who tend the palms are amply rewarded with their livelihood and the social services for their families. It is the end of day for the workers, for the weeders, and for the planters and harvesters. Malaysians of all races. Here their children are born to be tended and nursed, to be loved. When old enough, they go to school to learn and play and grow up strong and healthy. And become of age. Here, a marriage ceremony, dignified and colorful, the same as it was for their ancestors. Many of the old customs are proudly observed to this. Today, More than 150,000 acres in Malaysia are planted with oil palms. Still elegant, but no longer idle, they are now producers of wealth for the country. At about 2.5 years of age, took to the factory for processing without delay. To protect the plants, clearing and weeding of the undergrowth are carried out regularly and rigorously. This also keeps them within easy access. So every palm, and there are over 1 million trees in a large estate, must be visited at least once a week throughout the year. As the fruits quickly deteriorate once picked, they must be transportmental and indolent. Then in 1917, a French planter, Monsieur Henri Fauconnier, decided to make this elegant idler earn a living. He laid out the first pioneer oil palm plantation with a processing factory in Selangor. And soon other planters followed his example on a big scale. The oil palm starts to earn its living, constantly flowering and fruiting. When a bunch starts to shed a few loose fruits, it can be considered ripe for harvesting. Picked early or too late by a few days, the oil will lose quality.